have with us the very special Nirupama Subramanian. Very interesting thing that you said is that you found your passion.
Yes.
Well in time. Was there something that, you know, spiked that? Was there an incident, you know, that day where that realization really came that, yeah, this is my calling?
So I don't think it was one day. I think it was a gradual build-up for me, more in terms of eliminating what I didn't want to do, which is really banking operations. And what I wanted to do was engage more with people, engage face-to-face, help and support people. And the more I did it, the more sure I was that this is what I wanted to do.
Nice.
Yeah. So I also have a lot of admiration for women who go back into a full-time role and who still bear the domestic load, right? So interestingly, women do 356 minutes of unpaid domestic work in a day versus 56 wow. minutes for men. That's OECD data in India, right? So men also wanted to be, you know, play a bigger role in bringing up their kids. So I felt inclusion, diversity, and supporting a better gender balance at work was something I was really called to do.
Another very interesting field, and you've written a lot about it,
yes.
is actually about leadership with inclusion.
Correct.
According to you, are the top qualities which really a leader needs to bring to a workplace to actually make his or her team feel included?
Okay, and that's a great question, and I'm very passionate about that because we speak a lot about diversity, and diversity is relatively easy to have, right? You hire X number of people, usually gender diversity is easier, but you can also hire differently abled people, LGBTQ, you get some people from a different geography, so you can get diversity. But inclusion is a much bigger challenge because it's a mindset change that is required. So somebody once said diversity is about inviting people to the party, but inclusion is about giving them a seat at the table, right? Actually inviting them to have a seat at the table. Another reason why I think it's extremely important is because inclusion actually leads to better employee engagement. It's just common sense, and there's data to show that when employees feel included, they're more productive, your attrition levels are lower, there is greater psychological safety in a team. So it actually makes a lot of business sense for leaders to be inclusive. The pain of exclusion or social exclusion is the same as physical pain, which is why it's a very critical leadership challenge today. And you ask me, what do leaders need to know? So we have an interesting model, which I call the ECHO model, which is the four qualities that are really needed for inclusive leadership. So the E is, can I have empathy? Empathy is a very critical leadership quality. So empathy instead of disconnection. Can I understand what that person might be feeling even though I'm not the person? So can a male manager know what a new mother might be feeling? So can I know what a differently abled person might be going through? The second is curiosity, right? Instead of judgment. Judgment comes easily. Oh, you know, we always are looking at people as, is this person in my in-group or my out-group, and quickly judging them. And judging is very natural and normal, but it again leads to distance and disconnection. The H is humility instead of arrogance. Humility is being able to say, hey, I don't know. When you say I don't know, it's a positive admission that you would like to know more. The last is what I say, openness, mm-hmm. right? It's just being open to new ideas, new experiences, so that if you have that openness, you will be able to go out of your comfort zone and move from, again, distance to connection.
What about the unconscious bias?
I was doing a workshop for a lot of sales leaders in an organization. We were waiting for the sales leader to come. And I asked a simple question, when is he coming? I didn't know anything about him, the name. And they said, no, it's a lady.
Wow.
And I just didn't even realize that I automatically assumed that the sales leader in this kind of an organization should obviously be a man. So I think the first thing is to accept. The second is to bring it into our consciousness.
My next question is actually more of a scenario. So the first scenario is, it is appraisal time,
okay.
In an organization, and a manager has been given a small kitty of increments to really offer to his or her team. One of the women employees in his team was on a maternity leave for 6 months, but the 6 months that she was around, she was the top performer in the team. How should a manager rate her? appraise her, considering that, you know, there's already a smaller kitty to of increments to work with?
I would say first question to ask yourself is what you're going to be doing, whatever the amount is it just? Is it fair? Right? And you'll have to take a call on that in the absence of a mandate. The second thing I would say is look at comparable situations. If it was not maternity leave, but let's say there was a man on your team who had a debilitating sickness of typhoid or jaundice and took off 3 months or 6 months, but was still rated as a top performer, would you be cutting back on his bonus or increment? And the third thing is what you're doing aligned to organization values? Last one is, what kind of a precedent would you be creating?
My third and the last scenario is, there is a new school of thought that believes that paternity leave should be made compulsory. It's not currently in India, it isn't.
Yeah. So many organizations in India do offer paternity leave, in the sense it's not compulsory. Many organization policies give up to 2 weeks paternity leave. Interestingly, not many men avail of the entire duration of paternity leave. But I see that changing going forward. A lot of urban, you know, men I know want to be involved with the, you know, childcare. So I would actually say that it's a great idea to give a certain amount of mandatory paternity leave for men, so that they can be involved, right? You either give the leave or it lapses from your usual leave. And in countries which have done this, so Iceland, for example, has a very interesting maternity and paternal leave policy where they give 9 months, 3 months for the woman, 3 months for the man, 3 months for both of them to share, and it has to be taken. So men by force have to take 3 months of paternity, paternal leave, and the women can go back. They can decide how they want to split this up within 9 months. And they actually found that there is a bit of a culture change now, they're seeing in the current generation, in terms of men wanting to be more involved with bringing up their children.
I'm really thankful on behalf of Pine Labs that you came down and were a part of this session.
So, thank you. My pleasure. And I'm very happy to see that this topic is of interest to organizations, and I'm very passionate about taking this word across to as many people as possible. So, pleasure to be here.